Hi, this is Dr. Lisa Marie Bobby, and you're listening to the Love, Happiness, and Success Podcast.
Goodbye, my sweetheart, my flower, my friend. Goodbye, till we meet again. Goodbye, dear beauty, to all that you've been. May the light that is you never dim.
And that bit of cuteness, that's Uncle Neptune with Goodbye, My Sweetheart, is what that song is called. I like it. It's silly. But our subject today is not silly. It's very serious. We are going to be talking about how to stop obsessing about an ex-boyfriend or an ex-girlfriend. And this has been on my mind because last week I spent a delightful evening doing an online chat with some of the members of exaholics.com. And if you haven't heard about Exaholics yet, it's a great resource. It's a website, it's an online community for people who are struggling in the aftermath of a breakup. And I've been involved with them from the beginning. I've done a lot of writing for them, consulting, and it's a great site. I love it because it's a place for people to go when they're really in the midst of that obsessing and just cannot get over a breakup or the end of a relationship. It's just a place where everybody's in the same boat and you can get a lot of support and companionship around that. But anyway, so when I was chatting with these exaholics the other day, it seemed like the theme of the conversation, I mean, everybody was just in the same place of, I cannot stop thinking about this person. And what do I need to do to stop feeling so obsessed and so tormented? And I know it's such a common problem, so I figured I would devote a whole entire podcast to it. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. Is if you have ended a relationship, what you can do, not just to get over it, but just to figure out how to take a bottle scrubber to your brain and quit thinking about your ex constantly. So that's what is on our agenda today. But first of all, before we start talking, if you are just now listening to this show, I'd like to say hi. I'm Dr. Lisa Marie Bobby. I am here because I'm trained as a psychologist. I'm also a marriage counselor and I'm a life coach. And so in my practice in Denver, I specialize in love, happiness, and success. I work with a lot of people around all things relationships, you know, having better relationships, getting along with their family, friendships, breakups, dating coaching, all that kind of good stuff, but also individual issues. Anxiety, depression, being a better person, you know, personal evolution, and then also life coaching. I'm a board certified life coach. So, you know, I really specialize in not just what's going on and how you feel about that, but now what are you going to do to change it? And so I started making this podcast a while back because I thought that you might be able to benefit from some of this information too. And so I started recording these podcasts just kind of as of my own personal service project to put some good information out in the world. And hopefully it finds you in your moment of need and that you benefit from it or can share it with other people. If you hear some of these podcasts, it might not totally apply to you, but you think, oh, my friend really needs to hear that. Pass it along. And I'd love it if you stay in touch with me. Join me on Facebook, facebook.com/Dr. Lisa Bobby, or Twitter @Dr. Lisa Bobby. Tell me what you would like to hear about so that I can make some podcasts that are based around your interests and your needs, because I always want these to be helpful to people. And last but not least, if you haven't already, I have even more good stuff for you available on my website. You can go to my practice website, which is growingself.com, or you can also just go straight to my blog and podcast at drlisabobby.com and sign up for my happiness class. I made a free online tutorial, like this cognitive training that I teach my clients so often. I was like, I have to just put this online. So I did that. And you can sign up for it. It's totally free. It's a training that will teach you how to develop a kind of mindset that will help you be able to regulate your mood and feel better on the inside, no matter what is going on the outside. So check that out. Take advantage of it. It is there for you. Okay, that's all I have to say about that. So let's talk about our topic today. Let's talk about obsessing about an ex and what's going on with that and what you can do to feel better. So, as I mentioned, when I was facilitating this live chat the other day on Exaholics, the theme of the hour was, please help me stop obsessing about my ex. And when I asked this group of people where they were in their grief process, there was sort of this collective like, eh? And, asking a few more questions, I quickly realized that what was going on for these people was that they were still in the space of a breakup. Even some of them considerably after this breakup had happened, like a year later, where they are kind of thinking and feeling and hoping and wishing like they could maybe get back together with their ex. And this is a problem. It really is, because as long as you're in that space of thinking that the relationship could be resurrected, it is very hard, if not downright impossible, to do the work of grieving that you really need to do in order to really heal from a relationship and fully move on. And so today I wanted to talk a little bit more about what that involves, what it looks like, and also give you some understanding of the biological underpinnings of this obsessive phenomenon so that you can hopefully leave this episode with some ideas and some things that will help you be able to feel better and feel like you can move on. So first of all, let me talk a little bit about just the phenomenon of a breakup and the biological basis of why you're obsessing, okay? So my dear friend and colleague, Dr. Helen Fisher, has done some amazing research into the biology of love. She is an evolutionary biologist, and she did a fascinating series of experiments where she took people who were in love, in that super special place in the beginning of a relationship where, you know, they think the other person is perfect and just super excited and really just subjectively feeling in love. And during this period of time, she put them into brain image scanning machines and took pictures of their brain and had a series of experiments where she got them to look at like a neutral control or a picture of their beloved. And what she found is that when people looked at pictures of their beloved, they had all kinds of electrical activity in the region of their brain that is impacted by addictions. So pleasure centers. So you have a deep inside of your brain, a series of neurological structures that when they're activated are your pleasure reward center. So if you sniffed some cocaine or shot some heroin or, you know, pulled a handle on in Las Vegas, a slot machine, these reward centers get all fired up with excitement. And those are the same reward centers that get activated when you fall in love. And she took another group of people and she took a look at their reward centers, these people who were going through a breakup. And what she found when she did brain image scanning is that the reward centers of their brains, when they looked at pictures of their beloved, were very similar to what you see with addicts who are in withdrawal, who are prevented from using their substance of choice. And so her hypothesis is that when we fall in love, it is really an addictive process. And I think that there is some merit to this. I'm certainly not a neuropsychologist, but what I see in my practice is that people can get really addicted to a person to their detriment. I mean, so when you think about the basis of an addiction is that you're using a substance or activity to change your mood, and it's causing negative consequences, And even though you know that, you still can't stop. That's kind of the definition of an addiction. People who are in really a toxic or unhealthy relationships are very much falling into that same pattern. You know, if they're not with their beloved, they're devastated and can't think about anything else and totally wrecked and totally crushed. The only thing that will make them feel better is to have an interaction with this person. Excuse me. And that this person is really patently not good for them. You know, it's not a high quality relationship. It does not bring good things into their life. This person does not have the kind of character that they can really sustain a high quality relationship with. They get cheated on, they get lied to, they get stolen from. I mean, all kinds of stuff. But even though they know that the consequences of this relationship are not good for them, and they might be far reaching, I mean, their kids might hate this person, their friends and family might not like this person, they might be shunned socially for their relationship with this person. It doesn't matter. And whatever they do, they can't stop. And so that's when they show up for therapy. It's like an addict who's like, you know, hey, doc, I can't quit drinking. What's going on? Or whatever. It's very much a similar kind of process in terms of the addictive nature of relationships. And so, of course, not all relationships are this negative and this toxic, although they can be. But what I also think is true is that when people are going through breakups, it's like you're moving into this space from where you are connected with this person that you really love. And this relationship, it makes you feel good. It brings you a lot of stuff. You have magical moments. And then when it gets taken away, I think that it's an interesting analogy to think about, that it is like going through withdrawal when you are prevented from being with this person anymore by your own choice, as you finally decide, you know, I had to, or if this person breaks things off with you. And so what you see is that people obsess. It is all they can think about is their ex. What are they doing? What are they doing now? How about now? I'm going to drive by their house and find out what they're doing. Who are they talking to? Stalking them online. What are they tweeting about? What are they posting on Facebook? What are they doing? And it's just this insatiable urge for connection of any kind and information. And there's a craving, you know, a real longing to be reconnected with this person, or have this person finally realize that, you know, they do love me after all, and they were wrong, and they can't live without me. And so a lot of fantasizing about that sort of thing. And so I just want to share that to validate the experience, first of all, is that if you're going through this, you're not making it up, and you are really experiencing cravings, longings, obsessions, and that is the normal experience of going through a breakup. It happens to everybody. It's not just you. And it won't last forever. And today I'm going to be telling you about some ways to move that process along. You know, I don't really think that there's any way around it entirely. I think you have to experience some of it, but I don't think that it has to drag on for years. And that at least is my hope for you. But there's a biological basis to support your experience. And so I hope that that brings you a little bit of comfort. It's just this idea that it's normal and expected. So, okay, but so let's talk about some of the ideas that I wanted to share with you, and that came up in this exaholics conversation the other night. Because as I mentioned, when I was talking to this group of exaholics, what I quickly realized is that on their healing journey, in their process, is that none of them had gotten to the place where they had been able to accept that the relationship was over. And this is really problematic because, as I mentioned, it blocks the grieving process and it blocks the healing process. And it sort of leaves you in this purgatory of churning away and thinking about the relationship without really being able to heal and move on. And so, you know, what I was telling them about is what I'd like to share with you, is that when a relationship ends, it's really a death in a very real way. I mean, a relationship has died. The end of a chapter of your life has occurred. Something that used to exist does not exist anymore. It's a death. But the problem is that, you know, in a real death, as horrible as it is, not that I'm wishing this on anybody, but that when somebody dies, it is permanent and it's concrete and it is just a fact that that person isn't coming back. And we have a lot of rituals in our culture to support that and to honor it and acknowledge it and facilitate it. So, for example, we'll have a funeral where, you know, people gather and they recognize that this is it and we're coming together today to say goodbye to this person and to talk about our memories and to, you know, lay this person to rest. And there's great power in that ritual. There's a lot of closure that comes from those kinds of rituals. And so I think it's important to partake in them. But with the end of a relationship, that's not what happens, is it? It's much more vague. You know, there's a big fight and somebody leaves, but they're still, you know, like 3 miles away. They could come back. And, you know, a lot of relationships, they have ups and downs, right? So you have a fight and then you kind of find your way back to each other and work things out again. And then that's okay for a while. And then you have another fight and goes off the rails and comes back together again. And so there's also this phenomenon of an intermittent reward. And there's another psychological principle at work here, which is, you know, like, I think part of the reason why slot machines are coming up so much in today's podcast, but they are anyway. But slot machines are so powerfully addictive is because they are intermittently rewarding, meaning that you can pull the lever 10 times and on the 11th time, you win, right? And so what that trains you is to keep pulling the handle over and over and over again. And the next time you do it, oh, you only have to pull 2 times that time. But the next time you have to pull 15 times. And anyway, what that trains you to do is just to keep at it, to be very persistent. And so relationships are kind of like that too. You know, you have a fight and he's mad at you for a few days, but then after you try to talk to him like 7 times, then he starts warming back up to you and then it's okay again, you know? And sometimes he's available and sometimes he isn't. And this intermittent reward kind of experience really sinks that hook in pretty deep. And what it teaches you is that there is hope. And if I try hard enough, or if I'm patient enough, or if I do the right thing and I say the right thing, I can get this person back again. And so these two things, the fact that it's not a finite death in the way that a biological death is, the death of a relationship, and the fact that you've had these past experiences that have trained you, you know, it could work out. It has worked out in the past when we've had a rough patch. Both of these things conspire to create this almost expectation that we could get back together again and that this separation is temporary. And so it creates this continued feeling of attachment to the person that you love and that you've lost. And that attachment remains very powerful, even when you're not together. And so with it, and that biological, so we've talked about the biological basis, and then I just described kind of the psychological and emotional basis to keep, you know, kind of grinding away psychologically and in your mind about a relationship, and to be able to continue thinking about it even when you know that you shouldn't be. These are the factors that are going into that. So when you are in this space, when you're still thinking about the person all the time, still feeling emotionally attached to them, it is so hard to acknowledge and accept the fact that the relationship is over, make peace with that fact, come to not just accept it, but appreciate it in some ways, do the work of grieving, and then really being able to move on. So, as they say in Alcoholics Anonymous, watch that first step. It's a beep. The first step is really hard. And the first step of getting over a relationship is accepting that it's over. So when I was bringing up this concept to my exaholics group the other night, have you accepted the fact that this relationship is over to the group? And it was like crickets chirping for at least 2 minutes while people were thinking about this. And then they sort of started slowly, you know, comments coming back in of like, I just can't imagine that it's really over, or no, I would be so devastated if it was actually over. And when that happened, I knew that we really hit the nail right on the head. And so that is what I would like to suggest to you, is that if you are really having a hard time getting over a relationship, to reflect and see if you are still really harboring hopes that they'll come around, that you'll get back together, and that, you know, there's still a future there. And if that is the case, I would like to suggest that you do the work of letting go of that relationship, as painful as it will be, you know, because as soon as you say this is over and really allow yourself to feel that, you're right, it's going to hurt. It's going to push you into grief, but it's a healthy grief and it will have an end, as opposed to this like kind of continual heartache that you're experiencing when you just feel separated from your beloved who may or may not come back. So here are some strategies that you can use to facilitate your ability, to let a relationship go and accept the fact that it's over and to start your work of grieving. So I think like step one, you could even just write that down. You could write a letter to yourself. Dear self, this relationship is over. You are not ever going to see this person again. You're never going to talk to them again. You won't ever be intimate with them again. You won't ever kiss them again. You won't ever have, you know, XYZ experience that was really important to you. That is not going to happen anymore. And that's a hard letter to write. It's hard to think about that that's true, because it brings up a lot of sad feelings. But that's also your reality. And to let yourself be authentically sad and grieve the loss of the relationship will set you free. And, you know, that's why you're listening to this podcast, is because you wanted to learn how to stop obsessing about your ex. I am showing you the door. It might not be a door that you want to walk through, but it's still the door. And as soon as you can do this, you will start to feel better. You'll feel worse for a little while, but then you'll feel better. You can also, in addition to writing through this and acknowledging the end, have a little funeral for your relationship. Get a box and start putting stuff in the box that symbolizes the relationship. You know, some little mementos and things that you got from your ex, cards they sent you, pictures that you have. Put little objects that symbolize the relationship in it. Close the box. Write a eulogy. You know, the things that I appreciated the most about this relationship are XYZ. And have a ceremony, because you deserve to have that closure. And so have a eulogy, talk about the things that you'll miss, and when your ceremony is over, put the box away. You can burn it, you can bury it, or you could just simply put it away in a place where you don't have to see it, you don't have to think about it anymore, but it's contained. And, you know, funerals are powerful, those rituals are powerful, and so to have that moment of closure might be really helpful. But, you know, and then along with that, I think, gosh, I hope that you're understanding, and I probably didn't say it out loud, that any contact with your ex is not okay. You can't call them. You can't text them. Go ahead and block their number in case they try to call or text you. Delete their contact. Do not look at their Facebook page. Don't follow them on Twitter. I mean, tear off that Band-Aid. Be done. Because if you are constantly stimulated with contact, and now what are they doing? And having information about them, having reminders of them, it's going to be so hard for you to get over this. So just have it be over. Take away all of their access to you and all of your access to them, and simply let it be a death. Let it go, truly. Another thing that you can do in order to make this easier is to focus on the parts of your relationship that did not work, and focus on the why are we broken up part of it, because I think that it'll make you feel more comfortable with the death of the relationship when you can remind yourself of those things. It's very, very, very easy to idealize and idolize an ex and think about the good parts of the relationship and the parts that you miss and the parts that worked, and totally forget about all the things that didn't work and why you're broken up. And, you know, maybe you initiated the breakup, and it's good for you in a lot of ways if you did, but it's really important for you to simply make a list of these are the reasons why we're not together, and be reminding yourself of that very deliberately, particularly in, you know, the first weeks and months of a breakup, to maintain your resolve and remind yourself of why this has happened. And if they broke up with you, I think it can be even harder in some ways, because you might not have all of the reasons for wanting to be broken up. But I would like you to consider the fact that you deserve better. You know, you deserve to be with somebody who can love you for you. And if they're rejecting you and not wanting to be with you, you deserve to be with somebody who is excited about you and who wants to be with you. And so that is what is in store for you in your future. And just consider that idea as something to move towards, you know. So those are some ideas and some ways, if you are stuck on obsessing about an ex, to consider. And really the biggest one is just ripping off the band-aid, having it be done. And then, you know, the other piece of this, in addition to having that closure and having the finality, is that then when obsessions start to creep up in your head, your job is to remind yourself, this is over. And I don't need to think about this anymore, because it's not happening. This would be a good time to practice some of your mindfulness skills. I don't know if you've heard any of my podcasts on mindfulness, but when I say mindfulness, I mean connecting to the present moment by using your physical senses. So focusing on, what am I actually seeing with my eyes right now? What am I hearing with my ears? What am I feeling with my body? What am I smelling? What am I tasting? These are the things that are happening in reality. And when you have intrusive thoughts about your ex, your job is to say, okay, I'm having a thought right now about something that isn't happening. What is happening is that I'm looking at the green lamp on my black desk. That is what is happening right now. And I feel the couch underneath of me, and I hear the sound of my own voice talking to you right now, or whatever it is. But to notice what is happening in physical reality will help you get out of your head, come back into the moment, and will provide you with a refuge from obsessive thoughts. Also, you can try a stop and replace technique, which is, oh, I'm noticing that I'm having a thought about my ex right now, and I've decided that I'm not going to think about that anymore because this relationship is over. So I'm going to come back into reality, and I am going to instead think about what I'm going to have for dinner tonight, or what I'm going to do on Friday night. I don't want to be alone, so I would like to make plans with some of my friends. Who am I going to call? Think about what we're going to do. It's this very intentional, I notice I'm having a thought, I'm going to stop that, and I'm going to replace it with a different thought. And those two techniques, they sound really simple in some ways, the mindfulness and also the stop and replace, but they're very powerful and they're very effective. You might need to practice them a few times, maybe at first 20 or 30 times a day as you have these thoughts about your ex popping into your head. But as you practice them over and over again, they will get easier. So consider that. And then also, if you would like more information on just the grieving process in general and what it might involve for you, you might want to check out a podcast that I published a little while ago. I believe I entitled it something like Letting It Go, How to Let It Go. So look at that or listen to that, and it'll help you understand more about just the grieving process and what to expect there. So check that out. But I do hope that these ideas have been helpful to you so far. So again, to recap, your obsessions are real, and it's linked to an addictive process in your brain that's stimulated by romantic attachment. So just know that. Also, you're perpetuating obsession and being stuck on a relationship by not accepting the fact that it's over. So do some writing, do some thinking, have a funeral, make peace with the fact that it's really over. And then it will really open up a whole new chapter for you where you'll be able to grieve and move on. And once you've decided that it is over, then you can also use those mindfulness techniques and the thought stop and replace techniques for managing thoughts that I mentioned too. Those are really helpful as well. So again, I hope these ideas help you, and I'll talk to you again soon on the next episode of the Love, Happiness, and Success podcast. Bye-bye.
Goodbye, my sweetheart, my flower, my friend. Goodbye, till we meet again. Goodbye, dear beauty, to all that you've been. May the light that is you never dim. Goodbye, my sweetheart, my ocean of glee. Goodbye is so hard, you see. Goodbye, sweet sunshine, and all you gave me. May the joy that is you always be. My memory stirs at the slightest hint of things that make you so you. I hear a voice like a ghost in the wind, and I cry 'cause you're only a dream. Goodbye, my sweetheart, my angel, my love. Oh, how I miss you. Never you fear. Well, I won't forget you, for I feel you near. Goodbye, my sweetheart, my flower, my friend. Goodbye till we meet again. Goodbye, sweet beauty, to all that you've been. May the light that is you never dim. So goodbye till I see you again.
Can you hear that? It's clearing up outside. Look, the clouds, they're moving away. Wow, singing those songs, they really helped us get through this. I knew it would work. I want to let you know that I really appreciate that I had you to listen to me, and I hope you enjoyed yourself as much as I did. Well, I think it's about time for me to finally go outside and greet the day. I'll get my coat on here. It's still dribbling outside, so I think I'll take my umbrella just in case. Got my keys. Right, I'm off. But before I go, again, I want to let you know that I really appreciated your company, and I hope that you enjoyed yourself as much as I did. I think it's a good idea that you too go outside, if it's not raining, of course. Well, thanks again, and remember, keep your chin up high, and may the sun shine in your favor. Bye-bye now.